Thank you. Thank you very much, Paul, for your very kind introduction. So, again, no pressure to a great speech. Well, many of you know me as the one of two members of the London Assembly for UKIP now. It's been a fantastic year for UKIP in winning the Brexit referendum and also getting representation in London for the first time for 12 years. So I'm very happy and proud about that. As well as being on the London Assembly, some of you may know that I was a teacher, a chemistry teacher, for about 20 years before I got into politics. And I was a teacher up until March this year. And my privileged teaching career has taken me to both state schools and private schools in this country and abroad. And one thing I will never forget in my teaching career was when I was teaching in one particular school in Eastern Europe. It was a private school which had some scholarships. And the head boy of the school was a scholar from a poor town in the north of that particular country. And in his graduation speech, he said this: "I'm so grateful for the opportunity that I've had to come to this school. It's opened my eyes to a world that I never knew existed. And from now on, I don't just have the opportunity of coming here, but I'm going to university in America. But when I go home to my own town, I see my old friends and I talk to them for a while. But after a while, I feel like I don't have anything to say to them anymore. I feel that I've moved on to a higher level, and I don't have anything in common with my old friends anymore." So that was a speech with great joy and also great sadness in it for that particular boy, Marco, who was plucked from his own town and given the chance to shine and to excel. And I think, and probably you think as well, the situation is similar in this country as well. And I'm sure you know the statistic that 7% of our young people get the opportunity to go to private schools. And good for them. And this country is known all around the world for being a place of educational excellence. Many times because people think of schools and universities in this country and they think of private schools and they think of the excellence that they foster and the culture that they have. But what about those who are left behind? Private school fees at the moment have reached a level where it's about £30,000 a year to go to a full boarding school. So they're out of reach for the ordinary working person and becoming out of reach even for middle class professionals and becoming very much the preserve of the international elite. What's the answer to this? How do we get all of our students, all of our young people from all over the country, whatever their background, whatever their socio-economic standing, to have the opportunity to go to an institution of excellence? Well, you know the answer, because we've been saying it for decades. We need to have grammar schools in every town and city, every district and borough, all across this country. So that everybody can have the chance to excel and to shine. And Mrs. May has taken on UKIP's policy. Very, very sensible of her to do that. But as soon as she said that, we have an army of so-called experts telling us that it's going to be the most dreadful thing for this country to implement grammar schools. And we heard in the talk this morning from David Sprayson in Lincolnshire, UKIP is asking for extra grammar schools on the behalf of parents and voters, and some of the Conservative councillors are standing against it, let alone Labour councillors and Labour politicians. But when these experts and these politicians talk against this policy, what they say and what they do are very often two different things. So we know that David Cameron can send his kids to a private school. The high matron of equality, Harriet Harman, can go to a private school herself and is very happy to send one of her children to a grammar school. Even the shadow foreign secretary, Diane Abbott, That, it's funny saying those two things in the same sentence. She can send her kids to a private school. So these people, they might say they don't agree with it, but by their actions, you know they do, because they want the best thing for their kids. Good for them. They're doing the best for their kids. And I respect that. But what I don't respect is the hypocrisy. But why should there be this hypocrisy about academic selection for those who would best benefit from it? If there's someone who is incredibly talented as an athlete, as a sportsman, no one would have any objection to looking out for athletic talent at the youngest of ages so they can have their talents developed, so they can go on to be great sportsmen. And some of our Olympians who have done this country proud are testimony to that. Who would disagree with looking for talent, musical talent, artistic talent, creative talent, those who would go on to be wonderful dancers, and taking them out and putting them in special schools for musicians, dancers, artists, and so on? And many of the champagne socialist lovies have benefited from that kind of education and selection and will be very happy for their ilk and friends to benefit from that as well. We need to make sure that we get these grammar schools implemented, that we hold Mrs. May's feet to the fire and make sure that she does implement this policy. But it's only really UKIP that are wholeheartedly 100% behind the best schools, which are going to do the best for all of our young people, no matter where they come from. But schools are not the only part of our education system, of course. We have to consider tertiary education and universities as well. And never have there been so many people in this country going to university, thanks to Tony Blair's bizarre policy of targeting 50% of students to go to university, whether it's good for them or not. And of course, it is fantastic for some people, but never have there been so many people leaving university with so much debt who are so ill-equipped for the world of work and employment. We need to make sure that university does deliver the jobs and the skills that it's supposed to. We have, for example, a shortage of doctors and nurses in this country. It's a mad situation when we only have 7,500 places for medicine in British universities, but there are 82,000 applicants. Now, many of those will not be suitable, but many of them will be and are denied a place. Similarly, for nursing, there are 20,000 places, but 100,000 applicants. So there are tens of thousands of people who would like a career in nursing, but are not able to have one because there are not the places to train our young people in this country to get the skills they need to do to have to work in this country. And so we create a shortage by not planning properly, and the result then is that we trawl the world, bringing people who have skills from other countries to come and work in this country when we fail to train our own young people. This is a madness which must stop. It doesn't just hurt our own young people, but it hurts other countries who are losing their best and brightest people to come here. And I don't blame anyone individually for taking the opportunities to come and live in Britain. It's a fantastic place to live. But we are denying people the skills, their own young people, who should be staying in their own homelands to build up their own services, their own economies, so that everyone can benefit from the investment that they've made in their own young people. Now, but some of the university courses that we have leave people less equipped and perhaps less intelligent at the age of 21 than when they went in at the age of 18. It would be fantastic if we did have these extra places for medicine, for physics, for engineering, and so on. But when we have courses such as diversity studies, you wonder what people are coming out for with and if they're equipped from work for work. And I know one time before the referendum, I went to a college in North London just to talk about our policy on the referendum, why Brexit is a good thing. And then it was time for questions afterwards. And one young woman put up her hand. I thought, oh, this is good, a good question. And she said, I've been looking through your tweets. I thought, well, very sensible. And she said, I see that you're against political correctness. I said, yes. I thought, this is going to go well. And then she said to me, how dare you? How do you not understand the harm of historical heteronormativity? I said, well, I'm really not sure what you mean, but I tell you, I know what would be good for you is that if you left your course and you go and learn how to be a mechanic, because when you're 21, you'll have a skill and you'll have 3 years of wages and you'll be able to stand on your own 2 feet. Good advice, I thought, but it didn't go down too well. And she had to leave and go to her safe space. Sorry. I didn't mean to upset her, but there you go. Now, our education system is overseen by a body called Ofsted. And Ofsted, yes, we have a new chief of Ofsted, I think, who straight away came out with some of the politicians against grammar schools. And the previous chief of Ofsted, famous story in the last couple of months, was resigned after calling the Isle of Wight a hideous, inbred white ghetto. What a dreadful thing for a chief inspector of our schools to say about one of our finest counties. If we have people like this overseeing our schools, something is wrong. We need a... Thank you. We need a body that will stand up for traditional British values. Values like honesty, integrity, reason, respect for the rule of law and everything that is good about this country, not values which are called modern British values, diversity and tolerance, that is tolerance of every culture apart from our own culture. And we need to make sure that that stops. Thank you. We need to make sure that we get rid of the crazy system of rating schools in terms of value added rather than real raw exam results. A system that will allow the best schools to get A's and A stars, grammar schools to come at the bottom of the table because they don't have a value added, and schools that maybe do a little bit but come higher than the schools which do the best, grammar schools, because of this value added system. We need a scrutinising body that will tackle the ravages of radical Islamism, which is taking hold in some areas of our country and our school system, which will be a damage to all young people in our country if it's not tackled properly. And we need a school system which will allow freedom of thought, not breed a generation of young people who cannot cope with rigorous debate and need to go to their safe spaces, like that young woman I was talking about before. We need also to get rid of the strict adherence to the crazy agenda of climate change, which is going through our science education, our science classes, and it's that is indoctrinating our kids. Indoctrinating our kids into loving these bird-chomping eco-crucifixes that we find being put up in all of our most beautiful places. Because in science, people really don't understand the two principles of infrared absorption and black body radiation. I'm not being racist there. That is a real scientific thing that doesn't get taught. And if people did understand it, people would actually understand that the climate change agenda is not true, it's false, and it's indoctrinating in people into accepting. into accepting a panoply of green taxes which are going to make us pay three or four or five times as much for our energy if we did you just simply use gas-fired power stations like we always have done, which is going to hurt the poorest people in our country the most. Now, it's only UKIP that will even approach these things. Other parties won't even come near to talking about many of the things that I'm talking about because they're afraid of being seen to be politically incorrect. But what I'm concerned with is the truth. What I'm concerned with is that our young people have a pride in our country and know what it is to be good British citizens and grow up being able to stand on their own two feet and know the truth, rather than being indoctrinated into the many systems of mediocrity and political correctness which have ravaged our country over the last four or five decades. It's got to stop. And UKIP, with our policies, with the most sensible policies on every area, including education, will allow us once again to build an education system which works for every young person and an education system which will truly make Britain a great country again. Thank you very much. Thank you.